All right, we're live. It's time for YATS. It's Wednesday night. Very exciting. My favorite other show. I think I say that on every episode. But seriously, this is number 68. Getting up there. I know. I know. We're almost as old as Larry is now. I'm just kidding.
Oh, man. Low.
I should
record this. I'm more than 68 weeks old.
That's a good point. These are weeks. Only a year. All right. Here's the intro. Hey, what's up, guys? It's Wednesday, August 28th, 2013. This is episode 68 of YATS. Every week, Wednesday night, yetanothertechshow.com. Check it out. I'm Matt Lee. Joining me this evening, we got Ant Pruitt. What's up, Ant?
Mr. Lee, what's happening?
Good to see you again. Larry Press also joining us. What's up, Larry?
Good evening, guys. Good to see you.
Mike Rothman, back from a little cold. Good to have you back, Mike.
Believe me, it's good to be back, gentlemen.
And from the Google, Richard Hay joining us also again. What's up, Richard? How you doing?
Doing well, thanks.
Good deal. Let's. We should start out with, because we mentioned this before, and it's the deadline is almost up, and I don't know how quickly Ant's going to get the show notes done this week, so the application deadline might be over by the time you hear this, but August 31st for the Mars 1 trip, the mission to Mars, one way. If you want to get off of this planet, you and over 165,000 other people have sent applications in so far. They said, I thought was interesting, some applicant statistics. The oldest applicant, 80 years old. The youngest applicant, 18. Which, and I'm guessing you have to be 18 to fill out the application. So you have the whole spectrum there, which is kind of cool.
165,000 applicants are going to be one crowded spaceship.
Yeah, right. that just says that they'll be good. They'll be well stocked for people if, let's say, the first four trips don't quite work out so good. Like, we can keep sending people. So that's cool.
Dude, this is not good. If I wanted to leave the planet, I'm probably trying to get away from people. Now you're telling me I got to go with another person?
I'm thinking the key is, like, when you get there, you need to just sort out your tribe real quick and then wipe out everyone else and then just call it good. Be like, nope, no more people. We're okay, thanks.
Lord of the flies.
I need more food and I need another rover because I crashed my other rover. But, yeah, other than that, no more people. We're good here.
Speaking of rover, where is that damn thing?
That thing is just trekking along. We should all be following Sarcastic Rover on Twitter.
Oh, Sarcastic Rover is the best.
Isn't so it's better? Gone about, I bet it's gone about 40 feet now?
No, it's actually gone pretty far. Let's, how far?
50 feet.
Science and stuff, man.
This barely qualifies as news.
No, but Mars one way does. And that is a massive, I mean, out of the 6 billion people on the planet and yeah, out of those that have internet and out of those that have actually heard of the planet Mars and this mission going to it, that's a lot of people that
it
have
is.
Signed
it
up, is. If you think about it.
Did you sign up, Matt?
No. I want to, but I'm going to wait. I heard on another podcast they were interviewing this lady, and she said that she wants to retire there and then die there. And I was like, that's how you do it. So I'm kind of waiting for my retirement. But
so
then, yes.
40 years for you from now?
10 years. Try. Try 5 years. Try. You'll be lucky if I'm here next year. But no, very interesting. I think it would be cool. And I mean, just, you know, just to be like, yeah, I'm going. It's no big deal. And all through, there's going to be tons of testing. We've talked about this before, and this is quite a long article, more going into like, the guy that's starting it and all that and his background and whatnot. So I'll put a link to it in the show notes, or Ant will. at yetanotherechshow.com. So, are any of you guys going? Did anyone actually apply? Are you guys all waiting to see if this even happens? No.
About like Google Glass, I'm waiting on version 2.0.
Right. Let's see if the first group makes it to Mars.
Right.
And we'll talk about, you know, sending. But pretty cool. Let's see. You had something about Nintendo. We don't really talk about Nintendo much on this show. I don't know if that's because Nintendo hasn't been doing much lately or what. But you want to... There's a price cut coming. Yes, Ant?
Yeah. The Wii U, their latest console, which is now optimized for HD television, it's currently a $300 device. It's now going to be a $250 device. And in my opinion, it's about $200 too expensive.
And these are out now, or they're still not even out yet?
They're out now, and they can't give them away.
How much was the Wii? The Wii was like what, $200?
The Wii was $200, you know, several years ago.
And right, and that was a hit.
Yeah, it took off. It took off. But again, it didn't really have a strong retention because people bought it and it was great for those 2 months of partying, and then they turned it into little bookshelves or Netflix boxes, you know. And this Wii U was supposed to be a big step up from the previous Wii and offer the HDMI, HD content and whatnot and better games, but nothing really happened. It's pretty. The Mario Brothers game, it's pretty nice, but outside of that, man, they ain't got jack.
Well, and wasn't this supposed to be the push to get them kind of equivalent with the Xbox 360 or maybe even the new one, but probably not the new one?
That was their push.
Right, or the 3.
That was their push. But see, now they want to cut this price because of the new Xbox One and the PS4 coming out here in November.
So instead of playing the "we got the best awesome specs and games" card, they're playing the "well, we're your premium choice" card.
Yeah, we're cheaper.
Yeah. We're like the Nexus 7 of tablets, except not as good.
Yeah, it's I don't know what's going on with Nintendo. I'm about ready to lump them with the likes of BlackBerry.
You might, right? Actually, I don't know though, because they have a lot of good stuff still. Like if Nintendo said, "All right, we're done with manufacture. We're done building these game consoles. No one's buying. We're going to develop for Android and iOS, and you're going to see Zelda and Mario and all your favorite, you know, games like that." Imagine Mario Party on a big screen with tablets as controllers or whatever. I mean, you could do a lot of cool stuff like that, right? And they have the rights to all that stuff. So it's possible.
Well, if that's the case, why aren't they innovating it enough for their current devices instead of doing stuff like this?
Right.
Being a crappy console. Well, it's not crappy. But being a lesser console.
Right? It's the Play School console.
Yeah, and then you now have... I also read today that they launched the Nintendo 2DS, not the 3DS.
Right, so you guys remember the 3DS, right? And like all those 3D games that just nobody used the 3D on. So they're like, all right, we're going to now make the 2DS.
Yeah, what kind of crap is that?
It's all the same games with minus the 3D. So they're like apologizing. Like, we're sorry for our stupid gimmick.
I apologize for ruining your optic nerves and giving you migraines. You know, that thing was so bad.
Yeah.
I want to do a quick game poll from tonight's panel, the five of us. How many plan to buy the new Xbox One? I don't.
No.
So that's nobody. Crickets.
Nope.
And how many plan to buy the new PlayStation?
Right here, brother.
One.
All right, that's one of us.
I've gotten them every year, and nothing's going to change that.
But see, do either of you, do Richard, Mike, or Larry, do you guys have any game consoles at all?
Well, no, I do have an Xbox 360.
Okay.
And I did have a Wii before that, so I have had gaming consoles in the past. Oh, see, that's lame. See, that should have been Ryan Swope.
I just went to GameStop yesterday to get a video game. Yes.
Yeah,
I
you're
play
just
games.
Rubbing it in my face. Stop that. Don't do that.
Wait. I have an Xbox with about about 5 hours on it.
Wow.
And the original Xbox?
Yeah, and I still have the original box, and I'm accepting offers.
You have Project Gotham Racing?
No, I don't think so.
Oh, man, if you had that, I'd make you an offer. It wouldn't be a very good offer, but it'd be... I actually, the only time I've ever had an Xbox, I won one back in the day when the Xbox first came out. They did the Project Gotham Taco Bell giveaway thing, and me and my friends, like, we went in a car, and half of us went through the drive-thrus, and half of us went in, and we grabbed as many tickets as we could. We filled them out all online and stuff, and mine ended up being one of the ones that won. So that I had that for, like, you know, in Project Gotham Racing, which was awesome, but then that was it. I totally lost interest in it, and probably trade it for a bag of weed or something. I don't know.
Yeah, I kind of totally lost interest in the whole Xbox thing.
Yeah.
And
what is this? You have to go to a store to buy a game? How does that work? You don't just download games? I don't get that.
You can download games. I have downloaded games. But I like getting my points shopping at GameStop, the loyalty points.
There you go. Got you hooked by the point system. Got the man watching everything you buy, from groceries to games at GameStop.
Yeah, and Google telling me it's going to take me 47 minutes to get to work when there's no traffic.
That's...
Yeah, I'm worried about the GameStop folks watching me.
That's good, though. That saved you, like, from having to get written up for being late, though. You know it has.
No comment.
Uh-huh. All right. So, yeah, the price of this thing is going to be $130, which is basically $40 less than the 3DS, and it will come out October 12th, if anyone cares. I like the original DS Lite, because I had this programmer for it that you could download ROMs and put them on the thing and actually play them on the DS, like they were made to be. Oh, it was so great. But I don't even have that anymore.
Several of those, they've been given away to other kids and whatnot, but... Yeah. Yeah, those things have been all over this house.
Guys,
using them for remotes.
To shift a little bit away from games, using these things as a set-top box, it's my understanding that Time Warner is going to let people stream stuff on the Xbox and it won't count toward their data cap.
I did read that.
That's net neutrality at its finest. No way.
Yeah, isn't it, though? I mean, that really strikes me as, can they get away with that?
It's their...
Well, Yeah, this isn't the first time that kind of thing has come up. I mean, AT&T was saying that, you know, they were going to have a thing where they have, like, the, you know, once you use 3 gigabytes a month, then they start letting you drink your unlimited through a straw.
Yeah.
But then, hey, the, you know, Uber special buddy companies that pay them, oh, well, they don't count against your 3 gig, right?
There you go.
Comcast did that too, didn't he? About a year or two ago, right?
Something like that. So all that stuff really kind of violates the spirit of network neutrality too, right?
Time Warner, isn't that the carrier that no longer offers CBS?
Yeah.
That is correct.
That's true.
Wow, no CBS.
Not everywhere. I think in L.A. and New York and Dallas or something, but yeah.
You know, they'll fix that problem come a week from Sunday.
Yeah.
When the NFL starts.
And then, you know what? Google's going to get... is going to end up, what's this Sunday, there's some package of TV that Google's supposed, of football that Google's supposed to be going after.
Is that, I got a question for you guys, is that in NFL's best interest, or is this in Google's best interest? And obviously it would satisfy both, but like, who's in it more, you know, who has more oomph in as far as...
Man, that's a good question, because both of them are bringing in a crap ton of money.
You're asking, which is bigger, the NFL or Google?
Yeah, I guess kind of in a way, right? In a way. They are both equally behemoth.
The NFL would like to just stream their stuff on the internet, right? If Google let them do it for a reasonable... Why does the NFL need, other than an internet service provider, why do they need Time Warner or whoever... Dish has the... It's not even... it's a satellite deal, I think.
Google's already proven it can stream massively live events, no problem, without a hiccup.
Right, we did a YouTube concert that was like, you know, millions of people, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, what's in it for the NFL is the guarantee. They get a guarantee from the broadcaster they work with regardless of how many people watch.
Is it Google can give them a nice fat guarantee?
Oh yeah.
And couldn't Google afford to give them a bigger guarantee because maybe Google's advertising is more targeted and you know, maybe Google can eat those guys lunch.
Well, and think about this. If Google's the one that completes the cord-cutting puzzle by letting you guys watch your sports...
Not even step away. I'll be right back.
Let's say it moves past the NFL and they do all of the sports and they're the ones that complete that. Because that's the big gripe, right? About
that's my dream come true.
Is sports, live sports.
You know, that's, we were talking before the show. I'm going to do a blog post on this because I think this Google Live has the potential to be the long tail of video.
It's
and if they do things like beat ESPN at the short tail, you know, the fat tail, they're going to really have the whole thing.
You're talking about YouTube Live, right? Live streaming.
No, I'm talking about Google's live streaming service that they just started, I think, a month ago or something.
Right. You can sign up for that through YouTube. If you like, if your channel has more than a certain amount of subscribers.
You have to have 100 subscribers.
Yes.
And you stream through them, and then like just like
yeah, it's YouTube. I mean, it's
pops up on YouTube automatically.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
That's
if that works, and if it scales up, if they've got the capacity to scale it up, that to me is they're going to get the long tail. That's
for someone that does shows and stuff. Like for in studio stuff, I have to use Justin TV. So if Google can bring something like that, like I would have all of this stuff basically living in Google's sphere. That would be like the last thing that would be needed.
How about every high school football game?
Or yeah, on the other side, on the yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And so if Google can get the long tail with that live streaming. And then they're willing to spend the money, and they can break the hold of Comcast or Dish or whoever on the bad end of the tail. They're going to be kind of a major video producer. I wouldn't even call it TV, but just video.
Super Bowl.
The Super Bowl, man. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know.
You don't think so, Rich?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I have no insight into anything.
Okay. Larry doesn't tell you this shit.
Sure.
I can neither confirm nor deny anything about anything.
That's what you're supposed to say.
Exactly, yes.
Anyhow, that's what I guess we all wanted to happen. But, Rich, okay, like this Time Warner thing, though, isn't the FCC or somebody busting for that? I mean, can they do that? It just seems anti-competitive.
Well, see, the problem is that, you know, the FCC can set guidelines, but then whenever, I think there was a case where Comcast took them to court and then won.
They right? own the pipe, right? It's theirs.
Right, I mean, yeah, right. So it's one of those things where it's kind of a game of chicken, right? FCC says, hey, you know, we'd like you to be network neutral. Please don't violate the network neutrality. And in cases where they do this kind of stuff that is seemingly, you know, kind of violating the spirit, if not the actual rule, you know, they kind of come out and they try to publicly embarrass the company and get them to back off, but they don't want to actually come out with like a you know, a cease and desist or some kind of an order that can be challenged in court, right?
I thought that they'd sort of come to this deal that the network neutrality would be enforced for landlines but not for wireless.
That was one of the proposed deals, right, that was out there a couple years ago. Yeah. But then
landlines.
But right, and this is landlines, right?
I don't know. I wish somebody would must, you know, it seems really chicken to me.
Well, in talking about the whole streaming thing, you guys see this for Hangouts now. It's doing HD 720p and stuff. I noticed on all our shows the little HD thing now. Switching, what was it, the codec was H.264, which is still what we're using for Justin TV through a high-quality encoder. But they're switching to VP8, and this article on GigaOM says next up is the WebRTC thing. So that's cool. And we noticed the app, we talked about this a little bit on AOTA last night, the Hangouts app got upgraded and took out a lot of the lag, which is definitely cool, because that app was getting horrendous. If they could just fix that with Chrome for Android, like, we'd be set.
I swear, I've only had issues once with the Hangout app.
In Android?
If I had 4G or was sitting here in my house on my own internal network, it was just fine.
So your lag wasn't like CPU stuff. It was more network stuff. Like my lag was like CPU, like with SwiftKey trying to load. It was just terrible. But it is much better. I've been using it more, trying to see if it's gotten improved. In.
You're not the first person to tell me that either. But now I've always wondered, why did I have different luck?
I don't know. Every time I'm in Mere Woods with the flaky one bar, it doesn't work that well for me. I don't know.
We got LTE here, but thanks. And actually, Libby just got LTE, which is awesome, because I go there once a month. So, go Libby. Yeah, Google asbestosis in Libby, Montana will probably come up. But yeah, so is there any difference? I don't know. Maybe, Rich, you know.
Mesothelioma.
Thank you. Exactly.
Yeah,
when you breathe in too much asbestos in the lungs.
Right, that's mesothelioma, right?
Okay. It's also called asbestosis, so.
Oh, well, there you go.
Is the H.264 codec like patent encumbered as well as the other codec that they were using? Is that why this switch is happening, or is VP8 better? What happened to WebM? I have so many questions, Rich.
Yeah, whatever happened to WebM?
Well, WebM, essentially VP8 is WebM. Right.
Is it just another version, or what is it, less open or more open?
No, it is it's totally open. That's exactly. I mean, we bought a company. It was a video codec company, and then we open sourced their code, and then there was these threats about from the MPEG-LA, and last year I think we had this the agreement with MPEG-LA where they said, okay, we're not going to have any patent encumbrances, you know, on VP8. But then Nokia jumped in a couple days later and said, no, we still have a thing that they're violating or something like this. Because they wanted to make sure that no one would think, it's a free codec and you can use it and there's no encumbrance. Because anytime there's an encumbrance, what they're really trying to do is prevent hardware manufacturers from building in hardware acceleration for VP8, which would have the devices so they can actually encode and decode the codec faster, right?
So why would that make a difference?
Well, the MPEG stuff has been around for years.
Yeah, yeah.
So people have already built in hardware acceleration for MPEG, and essentially if you have another option that they can build the hardware acceleration for, then it makes it difficult for MPEG to flip the 5-year switch and say, it was free for 5 years, but now you got to pay.
No, I see.
Right. See,
that
way, so
you started seeing those DVD players come out way back in the day that would take the data and read it if you had MPEGs on there and play them, like you could play because they had they were able to encode them. That was really good.
Stuff like that, right? So, and I know that the MPEG-LA, they claim that that's not true. But then, if it's not true, why would you try to go after a VP8 anyway?
Right. Why would you care?
If you don't care, then why are you trying to go after it? Right.
Yeah. That's weird. So VP8, what's the goods on that? Same high def and all that as WebM was, or?
So it is essentially WebM. I thought isn't there a VP9 coming out too or something?
I don't know. You tell us. Is there?
I don't know. I mean, I thought I'd heard something about a VP9 somewhere, and that wasn't inside of Google. That was like outside or something. But of course, maybe that's just conjecture by somebody that's like thinking it, but. I don't know. I mean, I think it's logical to assume that there'll be improvements, and I know that I know that we're probably very actively trying to get it to be adopted by HTML5 as a standard for video, and not one that we just force people to use just because it's open source and anybody can use it, right?
VP9 decode support final bitstream was first enabled by default in Chrome 29 dev channel release 26.883 back in June? I had to like count like June of this year. Thank you. So does that have any change on anything, or it's just behind the scenes? Like we're not
They made the number one greater, so that was there.
That's a plus. I've noticed
plus one.
Yeah. I've noticed the option to stream in VP8 for quite a long time now, but everything that I would stream to says don't use it and to use H.264. So maybe this will open up more support for that.
Well, see, that's the whole thing. I think over the period of years, I think people are going to see that the VP8 option has got some legs and that it's like Android, right? It's free. Unless, you know, and then, but then it's free, but then you might have to worry about some company coming to see you because they say they have some patent that it violates, right?
Right, or you use their Java engine or something like that.
Or whatever, right. So,
so is there any quality difference between the H.264 and this VP8 or WebM?
Are they well, do you like Van Gogh or Monet? I mean, Coke or Pepsi? I mean, this is hard to say. I don't know.
So they're equal. It's equal user preference.
Well, actually, you know, so, you know, it's like people come to me, they say, hey, I say, hey, I'd like a Coke. They say, would you like a Pepsi?
That's
is that okay?
Cool. No, Richard, this is like, hey, paint the Mona Lisa, and you also paint the Mona Lisa, and we'll see which one looks better. That's what this is. So does one look better, or are they both the same?
Or maybe you can't generalize. Maybe it depends on the kind of content.
On a Sony Vaio with a 17-inch monitor running at 1280 by 10.
Oh, but are we talking cartoons or sporting events or
extra graphics
or actors or
yeah? Okay, moving on. Did you guys see the vice president of Android product Hugo Barra is leaving Google for Xiaomi? Did I say that right, Ant? Is it pronounced Xiaomi? They're the Chinese firm that makes MIUI, if you're familiar with that ROM, the iPhone lookalike for Android, or whatever.
Heck, I thought they were an animation company or some crap. I had no idea. First thing came to my mind was video games.
Is it MIUI or is it MIUI? Is it GIF or JIF? Never mind.
It's the English language.
Potato, potato.
Right. But yeah, I don't know, is that crazy?
What's the story behind it? I saw this late last night, but I didn't dive into it. I mean, all that I know about Hugo is just he's the guy that just sort of
we saw
markets
him
everything for I.O. and for the breakfast meeting and all of that, you know.
Well, the breakfast was Sundar, but Hugo was all over I.O., right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Every year. And he makes fun of his colleagues, it seems like, during I.O.
But yeah, it says he's planning to move over to prominent Chinese smartphone maker Xiaomi in an interesting change of direction. And some people were saying on the comments that like that company has gone from like what a $2 billion company to a $10 billion company. And
wow.
Sees that like there's and with MIUI being Android and kind of taking over, MIUI is coming on a lot of these Chinese phones like out of the box. So
Well, and while Apple was able to, you know, secure a win over Samsung in the United States for copying their look and feel, something tells me that isn't going to happen in China.
And then some other people are pointing to this weird love triangle thing, but who knows? That's all hearsay, you know.
So you're saying they don't have the same kind of clout over there in China?
I'd say nobody has that kind of clout.
Mm-hmm.
Except the Chinese government.
You can't fight City Hall. That's what I'm saying.
No, they run you over with a tank, don't they? Isn't that what happened last time someone tried to fight City Hall there in China? It was in a square somewhere. But yeah, so like he was dating someone, and now that person is dating Sergey Brin, and so he left. That's what another article said. I have no idea if that's...
Oh, my gosh.
I know. So there you have that.
So wait a minute, Sergey Brin, he and his wife split, and now he's dating this chick, supposedly?
Right, and so Hugo was like, man, that was my chick, and so now I'm going to China, and I'm going to give them all your secrets.
Is this People magazine?
Yeah, really? This is kind
Daily
of
Star.
Yeah, People magazine.
It's all things D, but, you know. Yeah.
This is the plot of, like, As the World Turns.
Oh my gosh, where's my beer?
No, weren't they doing a reality show down there? They totally missed this. Like, this was their prime shot. That's too bad.
Good
too
Lord.
Bad.
Moving right along.
Google said they wish Hugo Barra the best. So.
Of course they do.
We'll miss
What else would they say? I hate that statement.
And we're excited that he is staying within the Android ecosystem.
I wish Ant all the best. I wish Matt all the best.
I can't stand that.
Yeah,
you know nobody means that.
Are you dating my girlfriend now? Hold on. Is anyone excited about Windows Phone stuff? There's a Nokia Lumia 1520 sighting in a leaked photo, possibly. We're not sure. A giant 6-inch Windows Phone, codenamed the Bandit.
Does this also have a 42 megapixel
The Bandit
camera?
Do you remember Longhorn? This is the Bandit. All right. What happened to
Longhorn? I want the phone with the fantastic camera.
Yeah. That's going to sell phones, and that's the wave of the future, or one of the waves of the future.
Is that this? A 20-megapixel rear camera?
No, I'm not. Can't big, like what Mike's saying. And vastly improved cameras will be a major feature.
Well, so let me ask you this.
I'll bet some people will go to Windows Phone just to get that camera.
But check this out. Would you rather have the 20-megapixel camera that Nokia has done cool stuff with, or would you rather go the Sony route and have detachable lenses for your camera?
Or Android phones you can scuba dive with.
Exactly. James Bond or Under the Dome Windows Phone.
You know, I've never seen one.
Go on, Mike.
The idea of detachable lenses for my smartphone seems like a kind of contradiction in concept. I really don't want to put the whole value proposition is that it's right there in your pocket. You pull it out, you take a snapshot. I really don't want to be fiddling with interchangeable lenses, figure out what's the right lens for this shot.
Well, let's ask the smartphone photographer point and shoot man himself. Yeah. Through it, but first let me tell you this: if you have the phone and it takes good pictures and that's good enough for when you need to whip it out and take a quick picture, but then you also have the capability of setting up an even nicer picture with an additional lens that, you know, it's always in your car or whatever, then wouldn't that be cool also? Ant Pruitt, smartphone photographer.
The cooler, that's a false choice, because the real choice is to have whip out your smartphone. Not screw around with lenses, but substitute electronics and get the same picture you would have with your detachable lens.
Right, or if you're going to whip out the detachable lens, why don't you just whip out the Nikon
DSLR?
A legit picture,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
That's foolishness. Like I said,
and you should review that. Do you review cameras ever?
If
negative.
Why don't you, man? That'd be cool.
If you can get Nokia to send him one, I bet he would.
Yeah. Or Nikon, you know, somebody send me something.
Send stuff just to be like, you know what, that smartphone photographer stuff is all crap. Our legit $800 cameras do take better pictures, and we sent Ant Pruitt a free one so he could do side-by-sides.
That's how you do it. Have you asked Nokia to let you use one of the 41-megapixel guys?
I will ask.
You got nothing to lose by asking.
I will definitely ask. I sure will.
And what if they say no?
I will ask one more time.
And then they'll say, you know what?
It is inconceivable that they would say no to Mr. Smartphone Photographer.
That is true.
Inconceivable.
Inconceivable.
But no, I mean, I think it's pretty stupid if you have to detach lenses and all of that crap on your phone. That totally pointless.
Is it also stupid to scuba dive with it then, too?
No, that's good.
No, there's the dry fit suits for that stuff.
Sure, or the Kyocera Hydro series we talked about on AOTA last night, looking pretty sweet.
I mean, some of those things are really, really, really well, and freaking Mike Sweeney has proven that with underwater shots.
Mike Sweeney also builds giant boxes for his cameras to go into for the underwater shots.
He's done that, but he uses a proprietary dry suit that he buys online. You know, it's called dry fit, I believe is what it's called. DRI fit.
I just pictured like his little smartphone in a little dry suit. Like, all right.
You use a real camera.
This phone is supposed to have a Qualcomm Snapdragon quad core, 1080p display, a 6-inch 1080p display, considered thin and light, with a polycarbonate body, and of course the 20 megapixel.
That sure doesn't sound like the Moto X.
But who knows? This is all spec, so who knows? Not specification, speculation. Sorry.
Speculation. Okay.
It's all spec.
Unnamed sources.
The Nokia Lumia 1520. I don't know.
Maybe I still want to see the 1020. I haven't been out in a while to see one yet.
You know, speaking of a $200 smartphone off contract.
Whoa. Stop.
That is big.
Are these even still available?
I don't know. That's a good question. I mean, I guess we can go to the Play-Doh.
We're talking about, of course, the Nexus 4 got its price cut quite a bit. Not even that much, but the thing is, it was a cheaper and not manufacturer-wise, it is a nice phone, but the price was much cheaper to begin with for an unlocked phone, you know. What was it when it came out, like three?
It was $300, yeah. Now it's $200.
Yeah, so that's pretty awesome.
It is $199.
Does that mean there's going to be a Nexus 5 any day now?
We talked about that a little bit because we saw the price slash on the first-gen Nexus 7s right before the next Nexus 7 came out. So we were thinking if that's what they were doing or, like, what is the reasoning behind this, Richard?
I would say, you know, just like the reasoning that, you know, we're trying to get the next billion people on the Internet.
Okay.
But, you know, I have no knowledge of any product releases or any kind of, you know, I don't know, laser shows or...
Why do you do YATS with us? Hold on. What do you have knowledge of? Tell me that.
Oh, well, I it's for the bad jokes.
Ah, well, of course. No shortage of those.
I like the Nexus 4. It's just too bad it was LG. That was the one thing I had against it.
I think they proved their... They prove they have what it takes to make a decent phone, because LG was always laughable at best.
Well, now in hindsight, yeah, I see that.
That's but, Kyocera, right? What's the first thing you think of when you hear Kyocera? It's like old... Yeah, you know. But they made a pretty decent... Those Hydras look pretty nice.
Yeah, and another thing...
Well, I'm just saying, as a BYOD device,
mm-hmm.
you know, yeah. to, you know, if you're going to go to these carriers and say, hey, I got my own device... And I want to pay the off contract monthly fee instead of the you know the subsidized plan cost. This is a great device for that.
That's really awesome because you're gonna get this at and it's still high end considering at the same price you would get a 2-year contract subsidized phone that's just coming out on one of the carriers. So just to have an unlocked phone that you can do with what you want that where we're at now with specs we've talked about this before like it's. Gonna last quite a while, you know. If you have a high enough processor, good enough RAM, like that thing will last. I mean, our Galaxy Nexuses still last, and
Agree with you, Matt. Totally agree.
So that's cool.
Yeah, the only negative, of course, is basically just AT&T and T-Mobile, right?
Yeah, like we can't use it up here in Verizon land.
Exactly.
You know, just to be a devil's advocate, you guys are saying that the hardware's kind of hit a plateau and that's good enough. But isn't something like a 41 megapixel camera? Or some of the sound processing in the Moto X, isn't that starting to be the start of more demanding hardware?
So in like if you took the Moto X for instance and instead of dedicating its two special chips to voice and gesture stuff, you dedicated it to processing camera images or something else. So you have actual dedicated processors for this functionality. Is that what you're saying? Like that?
Yeah, I'm saying that you know the smartphones that exist today, y'all keep agreeing, and I don't even have one, so I'm pretty neutral in this, that, you know, they're fast enough for what we do. But I'm looking at this camera, at the camera in the Windows phone, and I'm looking at what Google's starting to do with voice processing, and I'm just wondering if there's not going to be a real jump in the capability of smartphones and therefore need for new hardware. If this isn't the first...
Has the hardware reached its limitation for the amount of space that it can be packed in and the heat it generates and the battery power that it's getting? Like, I think we're at a plateau for a while, at least. It's like what you saw with cores in regular computer processing. Yeah. Like, you got...
Yeah. Okay, but Nokia has managed to do this 41 megapixel camera. Right, I don't know what its power consumption looks like, and I have heard that it's not a great big thing, that it's kind of got a little bump on the back, but that it's comfortable to hold still.
Yeah.
That seems to, and you know, Moore's Law keeps marching along. I'm wondering if there's not going to be kind of a big, you know, sort of a discontinuity in what people do with phones over the next year or so.
I think
there will be that kind of discontinuity. I don't know that the device is going to exactly be a phone, or at least the sort of candy bar form that we know today. Might be wearable, might be embedded in our glasses, might be a little clip that you clip onto the back of your shirt. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. It's probably going to be an implant, and people are going to try and get them out, but you won't be able to.
Which brings me to my favorite story of the week, the the New York Times story about researchers who have been able to demonstrate control over another person's brain over the internet. Did you see this story? It was published August 27th in the New York Times Bits.
What kind of things are they able to control?
Well, you know, it's really rudimentary now. So these are researchers at the University of Washington, and they've successfully connected two brains over the internet, two human brains. So it's an experiment in which the scientists involved were able to send brain signals over the net to control another researcher seated in a separate area of the campus. And what they were able to do is demonstrate that the remote individual was able to cause the local researcher to move his hand.
So, and we should mention, too, that it's not invasive brain.
Yeah, what I was going to ask, what's the interface?
The hat that you wear, basically.
It's an EKG kind of a thing.
You're wearing a kind of a skull cap, you know, a tight, close-net skull cap. Larry, you and I would be perfect candidates for this thing.
And, hey, how about that? Look at all that.
Yeah. See, I think I'm more the obvious candidate.
You
might be perfect, but I'm definitely obvious.
You know what this reminds me of? Mike, do you remember back in the Altair days, man, way back when PCs came out, there was a whole raft of people doing biofeedback.
Oh, yeah.
Remember that?
I do.
Trying to lower your blood pressure and stuff like that. But that's all. That's pretty. That's pretty rough. I don't know what to call it. A pretty low information signal, that EEG data.
Yeah. They did it with rats first. They said they got one rat to move this thing, and the other rat totally moved its tail just because the one was thinking about it. So that's awesome.
I find that really reassuring somehow.
Not. There's really good technology that's invasive, and it's not coming off the brain, but for control, for turning things on and off in rats. They can really do that kind of stuff.
The more invasive it is, the more resolution you have in the synoptic fiber things that they use to send the pulses. Anyway.
Yeah, that stuff's getting pretty cool.
In the rat experiments, isn't it the case that there are brain implants that are connected to sensors?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're little tiny
implants, and they can control, they can cause neurons to fire or not fire by, it's a luminous transducer. They change the color of the implant, and it makes things happen in the rat's brain, as I recall. But that's, that's not a skull cap. That you gotta have something.
No, because isn't the skull cap the one guy would have to think about whatever the thing was they were doing, right? So if it was raising his arm, he would have to raise his arm with the hat on so they could get the pattern, and then they just have to make the other guy replicate that pattern, and it tricks his brain into raising the arm. If I understand this right, maybe I'm way off.
Yeah.
Because they were doing that with the picture recognition stuff, where someone would think of a picture, and they were also doing that with the helicopter, the little gyrocopter things, that they could make someone make it levitate just by thinking about it. But they had them think about something, and then they mapped that pattern to the up control on the helicopter, and it made it fly. You're not thinking fly the helicopter. You're thinking a certain pattern, basically, and they're just replicating that pattern.
In fact, I think it's a little like riding a bicycle. You don't know quite how you do it. But you can be trained to
do it.
Yeah, seriously. But it's really coarse things like moving a cursor or, it's not fine-grained at all.
We should, Ant, did you see a spy satellite? Or Mike, sorry, Ant posted the article. But Mike, did you see a spy satellite launched in California today or yesterday? And Larry, did you guys see this?
No.
You know, I missed it. And I would love someday to see a rocket launch. I'm now never going to see the space shuttle launch, but I'd still love to see a rocket launch. And no, Vandenberg Air Force Base is way the hell down south of where Larry lives. So no, I didn't see it.
I mean, but dude, why would we announce a spy satellite going up in the air?
Because we already know. Like, they have nothing else to hide. They're like, you guys know we're spying on you? Okay, well, here goes another one.
We didn't announce it. It was Edward Snowden that announced it.
Oh, okay. All I thought about was if this thing is supposed to be classified, it shouldn't show up on the Associated Press feed for everybody on the internet.
I like how it also has a, what's that called? A tag for spy satellite on Yahoo. There's like / topic, and then you can click on spy satellite. That's pretty cool. There's only two items under that tag, but we'll see more, I'm sure. The comments
on that article was pretty funny.
The fact that that article was on Yahoo and that's how I just saw it was pretty funny as well.
See, I saw it on, I think it was on AP originally.
That's what Yahoo's read. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
The link was to Yahoo, though, and that's weird. It looks just like Google now. What is that? I rarely go to Yahoo, but look at this.
Okay, so your Yahoo is updated? They started rolling out an update for it. So I haven't gotten it yet.
I've got the update.
Is there, like, Picasa? This looks exactly like, I mean, nice job, Marissa, but that's kind of like exactly like the same. I get the colors different, but wow.
Yeah, mine is still the old one. Hasn't rolled out to me yet.
Is that weird? Does she have Google's blessing to just go out and, like, compete like that? Did she not sign a non-compete or anything? Or?
Well, you know, Marissa was the one who ultimately was given a lot of the credit for defending the simplistic UI of the Google homepage.
Right. But then do you go and replicate that for Yahoo and hope it saves Yahoo's butt, or do you come up with something new and innovative?
Well, you know, I mean, perception is reality. And the reality is that, you know, some service, ComScore, I think it was, said that Yahoo got more hits in the United States than Google in July because all the students were at the beach or something.
We discussed that last week, actually, Richard.
Because people got
more unique hits
every day to see the new Yahoo logo thing. That's the only reason. Come on.
Well, whatever. I mean, that gives a perception that Marissa's doing a good job. That, you know, Yahoo is still relevant. That, you know, their acquisition strategy is working. And, you know, and it gives people the, hey, I'm going to go back and check out Yahoo and see some of the things going on Yahoo. You know, so I mean, hey, bully for her. I don't think anything's going to. I mean, I don't think anyone's going to come after her for changing and making
Yahoo. No, definitely.
Yahoo.
I'm not saying that. It just, like, it's the same thing. You should. I don't know. Never mind. Whatever. That's cool. Maybe we could just make all of the internet look the same, and then people wouldn't be like, oh, I don't know how to navigate this site, because everything would just look the same.
Like, I just went to Yahoo. It doesn't look anything like Google. Are you saying the new Yahoo does look like Google?
Yeah, here, check this out. I will show you. They must be slow rolling it out. But
are you going to do a screen share?
Here's a lovely headline for us to be. 80 sex symbol comes out of hiding. Oh, yeah. But, like, look at it. Top toolbar. And then, yeah. Here is where you're, if you overlaid a Google, like, window right here, sign in mail, that's right where your thing is on Google, your share in the bell for Google+. You know what Yahoo's missing now is a social network. That's my email. Anyway. But yeah, they need like their own social network to throw up in there, right? In the corner. It can be like instead of plus, Matt, it would say like exclamation.
I just got mine. I refreshed and I just got mine. It's okay. Got the little cards on the side like
right
now.
That's right. Congratulations.
To it. I apologize for that. And it's not going to really matter much anyway if the Syrian Electronic Army keeps attacking DNS servers and redirecting people's websites like the New York Times and Twitter a little bit. Did you guys see this? Cyber
attack. Yeah, I did see that.
And the New York Times was down a bunch. What happened?
Maybe this is good, right? Every time something on the internet gets exposed that it has a massive vulnerability, it gets fixed generally soon. I don't know if something as core as DNS servers can get fixed in this way just because of how it works, but they're basically redirecting sites. They hacked into who was it that owned their domain? It was some Australian company that they got their domain through or whatever, and they got in and just redirected it. Like, I just point your DNS servers to my server now. It's not that hard. It's only as secure as whoever your domain name provider, however secure their site is, right? Because if you can hack their site, you can get into all the controls. You can change MX records for email. I mean, you could do anything at that point.
Get into that. So somebody had rerouted all New York Times to
Syrian Electronic Army.
Wow.
Which I don't think, are they even going to be a problem here in like the next few days by the time missiles get launched at Syria? I don't think there will be much of a, which I'm not saying that's a good idea. This is a terrible idea. I don't even know why we shouldn't even be talking about this.
Hey, why not? We were talking about girlfriends and stuff before. We might as well talk about this now.
Might as well. Smear it all over the place.
No, I back to Yahoo, though. I hope this works out better. Because I used to come to Yahoo, like I said a few episodes back, when they started talking about rebranding it and whatnot. I used to come to it, and it just turned into a crap fest to me. But this looks better.
You like the sports, right?
Yeah, I like the fantasy sports that they offer and the sports section in general.
Wait, you know, like unicorn jousting? Or what kind of fantasy sports? Like dragon racing?
Gosh, dude. Jeez.
That was for Richard. I come to Yahoo for news like Ashley Olsen's rare appearance makes for a real Full House reunion because John Stamos turned 50. So, party on.
I mean, look at this. The whole trending section and all of that looks good. And number 10 is selfie. I heard about that now being added to the dictionary.
Selfie
and I want to work.
Did anyone see the post where it's like it had a picture of like Buzz Aldrin, you know, went to the moon, 5 pictures, and then the girl that was like went to the bathroom, 37 pictures?
That's so awesome.
Oh, man, good stuff.
So sad and true.
You know, I think it'd be kind of cool to see a comeback for Yahoo.
Oh, totally.
A lot of us have sort of written Yahoo off, and yeah, it's easy when you go and see some of those headlines on their sites to joke
no,
about.
No, I know. I'm just poking fun.
They have a lot of views, as we've seen in the press recently. The most viewed site. What was it? The most viewed site in August, in July, according to ComStats.
ComScore.
Thank you. So, I think it'd be kind of cool to see Marissa pull this off.
Yeah, me too. The more competition, the better.
All they need now are Yahoo Docs.
Except they don't really compete with Google anymore, do they?
I am totally sure that I'm doing great.
But they're more than that now. Both
so we could go to the EU and say, see, look, there's lots of other people. It's all, see, this is an inclusive thing. We're good.
We're good. We're good, Richard.
Are Google and Yahoo even the same thing anymore? At one time, they were both searching.
Definitely not, right?
No.
One's trying to create content. One's doing ads and other life services. They're all life service companies at this point, right?
They both do mail.
Everyone does mail, Larry.
Yahoo seems to be more towards
similarities between them.
We could start giving our listeners at yetanothertechshow.com email addresses if they really wanted. I mean, everyone has.
Yeah. No, I was just trying to think, what are the similarities now between Google and
search? But Yahoo search
and mail.
Right? Isn't Yahoo search Bing now, or has been for quite a while?
I believe Yahoo
is one of that. It's one of those.
It just seems like they've gone off in totally different directions, almost totally.
I mean, Yahoo just seems more like it's trying to do more mainstream stuff.
Yahoo reminds me of AOL for some reason.
Yeah, there you go.
AOL portal. It's more
it's
of
a hub.
There you go.
Google's where I go when I need to get down to some real research.
Answer the question to my homework.
There are still millions and millions of people who use Yahoo email as a backup, throw all my spam in thing.
There's one of them.
I used it all the time. Yahoo Messenger once a long time ago. Oh, because we were playing Yahoo Pool way back in the day. You remember that?
Yeah.
That was a great game.
Yeah.
Anyway. We're almost out of time, kind of, but I do want to talk about this, especially with Ant, a Forbes article, "The Man Who Would Not Use Facebook for Anything Less than $1 Million." Is that your price, Ant? What's your price at?
No, it's going to be at least $2 million.
At least
two. At least two.
Oh man, he's up in the ante.
So, I'd use it for $100.
This story wasn't about Ant?
That's what I thought. Then I'm looking at this picture, and you're not a professor at Columbia.
No, that is a bearded, fully haired white man. I'm a shaven, bald-headed black man.
If we redirected their DNS, though, we could sneak a picture of Ant in there.
Yeah, but other than that, Ant, there aren't really many differences.
It's like Yahoo and Google, man.
Yeah, this guy's name is Eben Moglen. He says when it comes to his own data, he is like, he doesn't give anything away for free, so he says. He makes extensive efforts to encrypt communications, block ads on the web browsers. He has his own server, uses a dumb mobile phone that does not transmit personal unencrypted data, except that when you send text messages, yes, it does. But that's
He's the law professor, isn't he?
Yeah.
He was Richard Stallman's lawyer. He's like
he was with Stallman?
Yeah, he's partners with Richard Stallman.
Oh, wow.
And all that.
Remind the rest of us who that was, is?
Stallman is the GNU guy.
Makes sense.
He's the big guy.
Real pioneer of radically open software.
Open source.
Radically open source, that if you use a GNU package, you have to also open source all the things that you add to it.
Right.
Yeah.
He doesn't even call it Linux. It's GNU Linux.
So this guy basically says that, like, all of these, and we've known this for a long time, but a lot of people, again, don't, is that, like, when you use something like Facebook, if you post something that says private, you expect it to be private. You know, those of us that know better obviously know better, but, and that's kind of what he's saying is that, you know, he says that what's wrong with Mark Zuckerberg is that he pretends that he's renting you a private hotel room, except he's got a peephole. It's not, you know, you're completely private here. That's what he say. I'm just reading from the
article. Yeah, this is metaphorical gold here.
Man, right. The quotes are great. That last quote just killed me, man.
Yeah.
You see that at the bottom of it?
Read it. Thinking
about this bilateral bargaining, they're $1 million behind on what it would cost it to sit on my shoulder while I surf the rest of my life. That's now, not even what... Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, does that count when I open an incognito window? Or, like do you just F off for a minute, or what? Are you always there? Because I'd need a little more than $1 million, but...
He says, that's not what even Mark Zuckerberg is doing. He's offering me a vacation real estate on top of a waste dump at Fukushima. Why would I buy my vacation house there?
Because it's super cheap, bro.
The man's got a point.
Yeah,
I laughed so hard at this. I was like, this is my hero.
Well, he says, we're for openness, we're for privacy. What's wrong with Mark Zuckerberg is not that he runs a private intelligence service that will give you free everything as long as they're allowed to watch, but that he gives you the private hotel room with the peephole. So... and that's, I mean, any of these services do that, right? You have to know, especially now, you have to know that even it's all being siphoned up. So, like, act accordingly or don't. And it just makes me remember, I mean, you go down to the comments and it quickly goes into Godwin's Law, I'm sure, at some point. But somebody was saying, like, well, what do you have to hide, da-da-da, and I always hear that one quote in my head that, like, I have nothing to hide from people I trust, but other than that, like, get out of here. Always go back to that. That's such a great quote. Love it. And I don't trust you, Facebook. Trust Google a little more than Facebook, but not much.
No.
They're all businesses. They're all just trying to make a buck, as am I, as are the rest of you.
All I know is Google has made it perfectly fine for me with their stalking of me. just like Amazon. Amazon has made it perfectly fine for stock.
Because they're offering you useful stuff back. Mm-hmm. Facebook, I'm really not getting much use out of it. All I do is like blast these shows out there and make random stupid remarks to things my stupid real-world friends are saying, and that's it.
Hey, Ant, you better leave right now if you're going to get to the airport on time. As much as I want to say I'm in control of my life, it's nice having that little reminder.
Sometimes you forget, right?
Yeah,
sometimes
you know.
You're in a game and you're like, man, I can't. And then Google's like, yo, you want to miss the flight? And you're like, well, no.
Well, there was another one of these articles on Siri versus Google Now this week. And they were saying that one of the things that I said, man, I'm going to start using that, is this thing where you can just dictate to your phone and say, remind me to do something in, you know, a day or in 20 minutes or in an hour, and it'll automatically put it in your calendar. I mean, that's nice.
Or at a location. I used that the other day because I needed to remember to grab a new receipt book when I was at work, and I always forget, and certain stops need a thing. I was like, yeah, Google, when I get by the office, like, remind me to do it. And when I got at the office, it was like, hey, you should grab this. And I was like, thank you. I'm gonna. And then I forgot anyway, but. It did remind me. So.
So sad.
It's like your digital assistant. It's like.
But I use the things I really use the most on those is the note to self to remember things to talk about for the podcast, and then the remind me when I'm here or if I have to time something, like I'm cooking, whatever. I have to be like, yo, in 35 minutes, because I don't want to do the math with the clock thing. So I'm just, hey, 32.5 minutes, remind, you know.
So how do you do the timer thing? Do you just say 30 seconds over Tokyo? What do you do?
No, I say in an hour, beep. And then it sets an alarm, and it beeps. It's good. Trust me.
So lazy.
So lazy.
Yeah, the 2-minute egg timer business is totally destroyed.
Yeah, no, it's when you're making canned preserves and you're pressure cooking and it's weird times and the clock isn't always on. It's I'm not even gonna try and rationalize it to you people, all you people.
Oh, man.
All right, do we talk about everything except college football coming back tomorrow? It's all right.
Man, I am ecstatic. It's been college football season for 31 minutes here on the East Coast.
All
go
right.
Tigers.
I am amazed at how much people have been talking about Texas A&M for the last... It's amazing. I'm ready for some football games.
Yes. Bring it, baby. Bring
it. That's right. I want Manziel to be trending on Twitter for something other than something else. I mean, something for the football game thing.
See, if the players played year-round, you probably wouldn't have these problems. What happens, they get in a little trouble when they have nothing else to do. It's like, oh, I have all this money and so much...
You're in Cancun.
Yeah, you know, what happened to whatever stays in, insert your city here, stays in, insert your city here. Or
it's like, dude, I was in Bangkok. It's Bangkok. Come on.
Different time zones, man. All right, anything else? Were there any other stories you guys wanted to talk about that we didn't? Was that it?
Let me throw in one little quick one. I was listening to some Leo Laporte, all about Google. What's Leo Laporte's
this
podcast?
It's
This Week in Google.
This Week in Google. And they had Matt Cutts on, and they asked him, what led Google, or how did Google make the decision to go to HTTPS? And he seemed to be saying that he read Cory Doctorow's book, Little Brother, and after he read that, he decided to do it.
I did hear that. Yeah, that is definitely a great endorsement for Little Brother.
It's also a great endorsement for autonomy at Google. I mean, goodness, that's really cool to hear that a major decision like that can at least start with just a guided... thinking, hey, now we should do it, and doing it. He had the authority to get somebody working on the implementation.
And starting from a book is a lot cooler of a reason than starting because somebody made a browser plugin called FireSheep, and it totally pwned your networks, Facebook and both Twitter, which is why those networks switched to HTTPS.
I can tell you, he said that he gave two reasons. He said one was he read that book, and he thought we should do it. And the other was that the Chinese hacking that went on. This was, you know, back in quite a few years ago. I can't remember which year. Remember that Chinese were hacking Google. And so he said those two things pushed him to do it. But I thought it was sounds to me like I was really surprised to hear that an organization as big and rich and everything as Google that a guy, you know, a regular engineer can make a decision like that.
Well, I mean, I'll throw something out there. I mean, you know, there is an inverse relationship between security and ease of use. So you have debates about, like, UI and, like, do we implement this and does it require more, you know, processor cycles to do crypto and all this type of stuff, right? And then, you know, and, you know, internally, I would say we were more on the ease of use side of things before the Chinese or the alleged Chinese infiltration in 2010, where whoever it was, someone was intruding into the internal Google network and that was a bad thing. And then after that, they went, you know, totally the other way on let's like change your password every week and let's implement this stuff and wow, you know. So they went, you know, so the pendulum swung the other way. So that stuff happens. I mean, you have to adjust to the environment and the circumstances of what's going on. Right?
But going to HTTPS didn't cause it to be any more difficult for users, did it?
Well, also, but think about two-factor authentication. I mean, Google implemented that before most banks.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but that's totally different. That's making the user take another step. HTTPS is automatic. It's there. Your browser supports it. You're good to go. And there's also plugins. I think I wrote an article for HTTPS Everywhere, the plugin that kind of does that. But it is cool. And you usually see like vulnerabilities causing more of the shift than anything. So it is kind of refreshing to see that like they read this cool book that Cory Doctorow wrote and shifted because of that, not because something was getting completely hammered on broken.
Yeah, exactly. It's just another example of art leading reality.
Right. Life imitates art, imitates life. Da da. Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Sci-fi. Good stuff. Is that it?
Sure.
That is it.
That sounds like it.
Do you feel completely satisfied with the amount of tech that was talked this evening?
Yeah, and I especially never. The gossip. The gossip was my favorite part.
It always is. We should have more gossip.
No shit, we really should.
Right?
We can't have enough gossip.
We should start a Silicon Valley gossip blog.
Did you hear about that guy who was in that situation last year, but then he got out of it?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we could do them like Mad Libs.
Yeah, really.
I need an adjective and
fill in the blank company. Fill in
I
the
need
blank.
A four-letter adjective and all right. That's it. Thanks, guys. YetAnotherTechShow.com. That's my dog. That's our website. You should definitely check it out. Subscribe on iTunes. Leave us a review and all that. We hang out throughout the week on the Google Plus community. We write for techpage1.com, anewdomain.net. You can check out a GNU domain also. I know Eric from AOTA got a new article up on there. Interesting open source stuff. Ant Pruitt's Point and Shoot tomorrow, every Thursday.
Yep.
Tech the Androids Tuesdays. And, of course, YATS on Wednesdays. So thanks for listening, guys, and we'll talk to you next week.
Oh, wait, one more thing.
What, Richard?
Burning Man.
Oh, wow.
You bought us all tickets. Oh,
yeah, I forgot to mention. I'll put it in the show notes. There's a live stream of Burning Man at ustream.com/Burning Man.
Oh, nice. That'd probably be a lot more comfortable than actually.
Burning Man going on right now as we speak.
Burning Man's going on. They're going to burn the man on Saturday, and I think there's like some secondary burn the sidekick to the man or whatever. Something on Sunday too, but whatever.
Burning woman.
They should burn a whole family one of these years. I want to see like the wife, the husband, and then like a kid and a dog, and then just burn it all.
Just so long as they don't burn me.
That's well, all I'm saying is live stream from the Black Rock Desert. It has a technology element.
Loon. All right. Thanks, Mike. That was the best comment all show. We'll talk to you guys next week. Good night.
Good night to you, everyone.